Welcome to the Grace Abounding broadcast, sponsored by the Congregation of the Shreveport Grace Church in Shreveport, Louisiana. My name is Ken Weimer, and it is my privilege to minister the Word of God for you today. May the Lord Jesus Christ be praised and exalted through the message preached, and may He, by His Spirit of grace, grant ears to hear to each one He came to save and ransom by His shed blood on the cross.
If you will, take your Bibles and let's look together in Matthew chapter 12 in verses 43 to 45, where it speaks of an unclean spirit that has gone out of a man and walks through dry places seeking rest and finding none. And then he saith, I'll return into my house from whence I came out. When he is come, he findeth it empty, swept, and garnished. Then goeth he and taketh with himself seven other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter in and dwell there. And the last state of that man is worse than the first. Even so will it be also unto this wicked generation. So whenever you read verses like that, you have to always consider the context. If this parable here relates to that wicked generation, what was there about that wicked generation that the Lord denounced? Miracles and works that he did, they said, this fellow doth not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub, the prince of the devils. And from there, the Lord began to teach on this matter. And all the way down through here, it's like reading the book of Proverbs, isn't it? Good and evil. What is good? What is evil? These men, although they considered themselves good, were actually evil, like many in our generation. They would profess to know God, and yet the Lord's testimony of them is that they're a wicked generation. And it's nothing new. It's like in the Old Testament, it speaks of that. The Lord said, ye are of those that call good evil and evil good. They considered themselves good and Christ evil. And really what Christ is showing is that he is the good one. He is that. If there's any good, it's Christ. And let God be true and every man a liar. All right. So last time we picked up on this in verse 34, where the Lord says, O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? That's quite a denunciation when you think that who he's talking to here is the Pharisees. These were men that were commissioned to be the spokesman for God in their day by their religion. These were the ordained preachers of the day. And yet the Lord said, of all of your speaking the word, how can you, being evil, speak good things? There are preachers today that can take the things of this word and speak them to men, and yet they'll not be able to speak the truth unless the Lord's taught them. That takes the revelation of Christ in the heart. But we should not be surprised when we hear men on radio or read of their comments. I listened to, briefly to some talk, a call-in show by two preachers this morning, taking calls from across the nation. They'll take the word, they'll give answers, but they don't point men to Christ. You cannot point men to one you don't know. And so that's why Christ called them blind leaders of the blind. And he says, for out of the abundance of the heart, verse 34, the mouth speaketh. If you want to know where a man stands with regard to Christ and God and salvation, sin, judgment, redemption, justification, all these, just talk to him. Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. You're going to find out what's there. You may find some that there appears to be something good in some of what they say, but there's an awful lot of mixture of works and grace. All of these things, it's out of the heart. It's according to as how God has been pleased to reveal Christ in the heart, and so. That's where we were last time, looking at where it says, a good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. I think a good point was made toward the end that if we keep this verse 35 in its context, because the conflict really here is Christ versus this evil generation. So when it speaks here of a good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringing forth good things, what better fulfillment than that referring to Christ himself, because he is the good man. And out of the treasure of his heart brings forth good things. Everything pertaining to God. If you want to know God, hear Christ. You know, he is God's prophet. He's God's priest. He's God's king. As priest, we come to him for forgiveness of sins. In him is forgiveness. Those are good things. And as king, we bow to him. We bow to his righteousness. We bow to his grace. That's a good thing. But it says here, an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. And I'll guarantee you, what men call evil today, they say, well, we're supposed to watch our words. We're not supposed to say any cuss words. And they consider those to be evil. But the Lord's calling evil these men's words. These who profess to teach men concerning God, and yet they had need themselves to be taught the very first principles of grace and of righteousness. And so it's quite a condemnation. And, you know, what it is for us in our day, it's a call to discernment. People, you know how it is. I mean, it just, all a person has to say is that they're a pastor, a preacher, and people get all gooey. At least they do around me. Oh, really? That is just such a wonderful work. You know, you hear people talking about it, but when you sit them down and say, you know, well, this is what it's all about, all of a sudden they go silent. They go quiet because they're used to pastors showing up and holding their hand whenever they've got a little problem going on, or visiting them in the hospital, or, you know, giving them a call. A caretaker is basically what they're interested in. But one who's going to stand and tell them the truth in this day and age, it's like it was in Paul said, the day's coming when men will have itching ears. They want you to scratch them. Just scratch me here a little bit. Just tell me a little bit about, make me feel better. That's the kind of, they're not after doctrine. But if the Lord has taught us, we've got to declare to this generation, just as Christ did, the truth. Do it straightforward, plainly, you know, without compromise, without shade. Certainly that's who God is. There's no darkness in him. And therefore, you know, we need to set forth the light just as it is in Scripture. Now, here's where we come today in verse 36. I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. Let's stop there and have a word of prayer, and then we'll take a look at this. Our gracious Father, I thank you for drawing us here today in this gathering, assembly, and pray that you would quiet our hearts and minds as we consider together your word. It would be very easy to come to this portion of Scripture and stand in condemnation, you know, on this generation of Pharisees that Christ condemned, and yet ourselves be just as guilty. And I pray, dear Father, that you would take your word and humble us at Christ's feet. Give us the grace to know him in truth and not to be led astray by our own thoughts. And Lord, that whatever water we drink of this word, it might be the pure word that is of the doctrine of Christ, that which gives him all the glory. For he is the only good one. And Lord, if we're to be considered good before you, it's only going to be by that righteousness which he worked out and which you accepted and which you imputed there at the cross to everyone for whom he died. What a glorious standing that is. And Father, if there's any in our midst that are still in a state of unbelief, still in a state of darkness and rebellion and ignorance, and yet one for whom Christ died, that, Lord, by your grace and spirit, you would draw them and cause them as sheep to hear the voice of the shepherd and come running to him. I thank you that that is your work to do. And Lord, as your word set forth today, I pray that you would so be pleased to grant your spirit and regenerate and draw such sinners to yourself. We're thankful for your word, thankful for the comfort it brings, for the rest and hope that we have in the Christ that it sets forth. And Lord, I pray that you'd give us eyes and ears, eyes to behold him, ears to hear him, hearts to bow to his word. We're thankful. In Christ's precious name I pray. Amen. Again, we've probably heard messages preached on some of these individual parts, but sometimes when you come and see them, how they fit in the whole scheme of things, which is really how we're to study the scriptures anyway, sometimes there's some new light that's brought here. Two words you used was legalism, guilt, bondage, and no gospel, all right? Well, especially when you stop and think of the implications. If every idle word a believer is still accountable for in the day of judgment, even though Christ died for him, what about every idle thought? Because the word, you know, the scripture says even the thought of foolishness is sin. Even the thought of foolishness, all right? So many have used this to try to rein people in. Now, having said that, it doesn't mean that we're just to exercise our liberty and go around just cussing up a storm. You know, there are extremes here to where people say, well, it's all under the blood. And so they have filthy mouths. I know some grace people that take it that way. And if you question why they speak the way they do, they say, well, that's legalistic. So this is not a license just to speak at will, but what in the context, what we're looking at is you know, if there is a word for which, you know, then you get down to defining, well, what is an idle word? If we, you know, I've heard people correct you for talking about anything but the message after the service, because, you know, if you get into, well, how you doing and how's Aunt so-and-so, you know, pretty soon it's, oh, well, someone will pop up with this verse. Let's be careful with idle words. So, I mean, you can see how it's been used like a 10-prong whip, you know, just to try to keep people in line. Actually, again, looking at this in context, what does it pertain to? When the Lord, you know, why does he speak up here? Why does he say that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment? Let's see this in its context. Who is he talking to here? He's talking to the keepers of the law. And when you go back and read some of their interpretations of the law, they did exactly like many religions do. They classified sins between greater and lesser. In their minds, okay, we've got to deal with God's justice somehow. So the way we're going to deal with it is if you commit these sins that are in this upper echelon, then you really are in trouble. But if you happen to be down here in this lower echelon, we're all, you know, it's sort of the expression, why aren't we all sinners? So these God will forgive, but these up here, you better be careful. And they had their standards for which they would put somebody out of the synagogue. They had church discipline based on these standards. It wasn't the word, it was their interpretation of the word. And you may have heard of the different schools of interpretation that existed even back in Christ's days. Some followed the, you know, this one school that had 635 interpretations, and this other followed this one that had, you know, 500 and some. But each one divided according to the rules. Doesn't that sound like a pattern today? You know, you go into a congregation, and what's the first thing they ask for? Let's see your constitution. Because they've just come from a church where they've been put out. They want to see on what ground they'll be accepted or rejected here. Everybody's got their rules of interpretation. It's not the word, but it's like that little old password game that you lay a layer over top of the word to be able to see a word. they're laying a filter over top of Scripture, and that's the basis upon which they judge men. So what Christ is doing here in verses 36 and 37 is full force of the law against them that boasted of being the keepers of the law. Can you think of one other passage in Scripture where he really brought this out to them? In Matthew chapter 5, you say, if a man steals or if a man commits adultery, you know, they had certain definitions of what that meant. But then Christ said, but I say unto you, if a man so much as looks upon a woman, lusts after her, then he's committed adultery with her in his heart. He's bringing the full force of the law against those who boast of keeping it. And to me, this is, you know, if the Lord's taught you by his grace, you're not boasting of being a keeper of the law. You're boasting of the one who kept the law perfectly, Christ. There's your hope. But I'll tell you, if a man continues to think, just like you're talking about, a preacher who reins his life in, because he's trying to prove to people that at least on the point of the idle word, that he's mastered the law somehow, he's going to be sadly disappointed if that's his hope, if that's his ground of hope. You know, by an idle word is meant what the Jews called light conversation or vain discourse. And for them, this was something that they would say was just, you know, God can forgive that. We're just chit-chatting here. This is off the record. It's like people say it's off the record. I'll tell you, if you boast of keeping the law, nothing's off the record. Nothing's off the record. And since not forgiven nor repented of, it'll be accounted for. That's what Christ is saying. It'll be accounted for. You want God to judge you based upon the standard that you hold over other men? You will be. That's why I preach grace. That's why I preach the gospel, because that's the standard upon which I hope to be judged. Not my righteousness, but his. Not what I've done, but what he's done. Not me, but him. You know, that's substitution. And that's why I preach it. That's why I hold that up as a standard. And when you hear people say, yes, but isn't there something else? You can look them in the eye and say, it's that something else that's going to send you to hell unless God causes you to submit to the one true righteousness of Christ. You want God to judge you on that something else? I don't. So that's the point here. And again, it's true. It starts off with the blasphemies, you know, these. But Christ is saying, even if you're not amongst these blasphemy, even your idle words, he's bringing the full force of the law. Because there may have been some that were kind of chuckling. You know how a crowd is. They may have been saying, boy, he's nailing them. And so the Lord's saying, whoa, even your idle words, even your idle words, unless Christ has borne that sin and unrepented of, it's going to be accounted for. So, you know, that's, and then verse 37, I believe that's the sense. By thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. What is it that you plead now? I plead Christ. Well, I'll either be justified by pleading him, or I'll be condemned by pleading my own righteousness. Those are the two alternatives. There's no in-between ground. You know, when you arrest a man, or the police arrest a man, that part of the statement is anything you say can and will be used against you in a court of law. You know, that's what Christ is saying here. This is an arrest. He's arresting these men by his word. And he's saying anything you say and do right now can and will be held against you in God's court of law. It's a call to carefulness in whatever stand a man takes in things pertaining to God and Christ. That's why it's serious. A lot of people like to say, well, this is just a theological discussion. Let's don't make it as serious as what you're making it. It's not a theological discussion. It's the difference between life and death. It's the difference between his righteousness and ours. It's the difference between grace and works. Can't you see that? And someone will say, boy, you're really getting worked up on this. Well, it's eternal matters. It's eternal matters. You know, a man that has spoken for Christ and has freely confessed that all his hope of justification before God and acceptance with him is solely on the account of the righteousness of Christ imputed, that man will be declared justified in the court of heaven. I just, I truly believe it. That's because that's what this word says. A man cannot believe that and rest in that and stick to it all his life and have a false hope. That's what Christ is talking about here. But a man that has spoken hard speeches against Christ, and even in under the guise of grace, denounces that finished work that he's accomplished, on what ground can he expect justification before God? He'll be condemned unless God grants him repentance. He'll be convinced in that day. It's easy to stand and argue these things, you know, before men, but it's a whole different thing to stand in the court of law and pretend to argue it before a holy God. He'll be condemned by those ungodly sayings. This is the point I wish we could see. We're not talking about just sitting in a corner and smoking a cigar and telling dirty jokes and cussing and condemning that as ungodly. But any sort of denunciation of Christ and his finished work, and to take a stand against it and to say that somehow man has some to make the condition on the sinner in any way, like these were doing, unless the Lord grants repentance, it'll stand against you in the day of judgment. You will be judged by those words. In other words, by the full force of God's holy law, and you know, be condemned. Didn't Job eventually get to that point where he said, if I open my mouth, even my words will condemn me? The Lord's got to bring us to silence in these matters. But as long as we're arguing, as long as I got one more thing to say about, well, if you stick by that argument, you will have to answer for it, you know, in the day of judgment. I think some that I've read have thought that Christ here is striking at the very notion among the Jews that you know, little or no account would be taken of man's words in the day of judgment. But as we read in the book of James, there are no exceptions. You violate the law in one, you violated the whole thing. And that's really why these are non-negotiable terms, aren't they, even for us? When people sit down and say, well, let me just play the devil's advocate for a while. No. You know, that's dangerous ground. When a person wants to do that, they're not convinced. They're not convinced. Our mouth is stopped. You know, I've been over this ground. The Lord's taught me. There's no hope there in works or in anything that I've got to complete or finish or do. In fact, that's a very dangerous ground to be on. You know, words are, it's not only in light conversation, but it's what they stand up, you know, and preach and tell others to do. That is contrary to the clear revelation of Christ being our righteousness. Let's just look here in verse 38. It says, then certain of the scribes and the Pharisees answered, saying, Master, we would see a sign from thee. Now, it's important to look at transitions in Scripture. You might, at first reading, think that this is the same type of Pharisee to whom Christ has just been speaking. But remember, I said in a crowd, there might be some sitting there thinking, boy, he's really nailing them. Even the Pharisees amongst themselves differed. And I believe that what we have here in verse 38, although they're both Pharisees, they're both of the same root and stock, yet outwardly they present themselves differently, because these men understood things were intense. Christ is nailing these others, who back in verse 24, see, up to now, that's who he was dressing. He was, when the Pharisees said, this fellow doth not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub, the prince of the devils. And so you have this whole discourse of Christ from verse 25 down to verse 37. And then you get this transition here in verse 38. Then certain of the scribes, then. See, as a result of what he's just saying, don't they try to change colors a little bit like a chameleon? Oh, okay, well, I'm going to move over onto this terrain then, because this over here, he's really nailing these. So let's see some miracles. I'm willing to give you the credit. I'm willing to acknowledge that there might be something to it. Master, we would see a sign from thee. You know, it appears to me anyway that these Pharisees mentioned here were trying to present themselves a bit differently to Christ. Not that they were any different, as we're going to see Christ answer. Because don't we get sidetracked by men's flattery? We do. You know, you might be saying some hard things over here, and it might be to one of your kids, and so this one over here is going to think, well, I'm going to schmooze. Because I don't want this sort of, but they're all guilty. You know, maybe you caught all of them doing the same thing, but each one's going to try to make himself look less guilty than the other. All right? I believe that's what we've got going on. Verse 24, the group that cavilled at Christ and attributed his work to that of Satan himself. And then you've got these in verse 38. That may have been some who saw no reason to discredit the miracles of Christ like that. They would be the kind to say, well, I wouldn't quite go that far. You know, I wouldn't quite say that. But on the other hand, they wouldn't content themselves either with what they had already seen. You know, what other proof did they need? So really, both are unbelief. Both are forms of unbelief, just outwardly present themselves differently. They may have here considered themselves safe for pretending to study further. You ever get that kind of answer from people? Well, I'll give it some further consideration. A lot of times that's just a guise for, I really don't believe what you have to say. And if they did it with Christ, don't be surprised when they do it with you. I'll take these under advisement, as if they're judges to be able to do so. See, that's the one problem with men, is they set themselves as judges over the work of Christ, judges over the word of Christ, judges over the person of Christ, and then they, whatever conclusion they draw, they expect men to follow that particular conclusion. And that's who Christ is calling here in verse 39, an evil and adulterous generation. He's letting them know you're on no better ground with that than these others. You know, it would be better to come right out and just say what these others are saying, is what he's saying. He said, you're all in unbelief, even though they compliment him with the term master. You see that in verse 38? Master, we would see a sign of thee. Their request is, you know, to see a sign. They could probably go back to Scripture and say, well, we're just basing this on Scripture. Scripture says that the Messiah would do certain things. So now, that's all we're asking. Nonetheless, Christ shows them that such thinking didn't relieve them of the same condemnation. I believe that's the sense here, that it was just merely a different form of unbelief. And doesn't unbelief take different forms? I mean, there's some that's pretty flagrant. You can look at it and say, boy, that's unbelief if I've ever seen it. But there's some that's pretty subtle. Any unbelief that does not bow to Christ and his word, how he reveals himself, it's still unbelief, no matter how you reshape it, repackage it. So Christ's response here is the same as we see throughout Scripture. He denounces all hypocrisy. He denounces all self-righteousness is a cover for unbelief. He condemns that demand even. And you say, well, good grief, is he in a bad mood? No, he's the truth. He condemns even that demand as the language of an evil and an adulterous generation in verse 39. He said an evil and adulterous generation seeks after a sign. And that word evil is, it's the same context all the way up through, and it's going to relate here to this evil spirit going out. So just like you have the word all the way through here in speaking, you have the word evil all the way through here. All right? And adulterous, this is talking about spiritual adultery.
You've been listening to the Grace Abounding broadcast brought to you by the Congregation of the Shreveport Grace Church in Shreveport, Louisiana. We meet at 2970 Baird Road and invite you to join us each Sunday beginning at 10 a.m. For more information, please visit our website at www.shrevegrace.org or call 318-687-4943. Please plan to join us again next week.